National Football League made a few interesting changes in 1930. The most major was to allow teams to carry a 22-man roster after the third game of the season, up from the normal 18. However, only 20 could be in uniform at any given game. Violation of this rule resulted in a $500 fine and game forfeiture. Also, the Dayton club transferred to Brooklyn and became the Dodgers, eliminating the league's connection to the original Ohio League. Nostalgically, Dayton had played the league's very first game back in 1920. From 1920 to 1931, the league determined the champion by the best winning percentage. Ties did not factor into the calculation. Also, teams determined their schedules dynamically. Therefore, clubs played differing numbers of games during any given season. As an example, a team with 8 wins, 2 losses, and a tie would have been declared champion over a team with 9 wins, 3 losses, and no ties. In the 1930 episode of The Starters, the Green Bay Packers are fighting for the title for a second straight season. They held a winning percentage edge over the New York Giants by only .004. They desperately needed a win or a tie over Portsmouth to take the championship. Once again, the Packers found themselves in the unenviable position of having to clinch a championship on the road, playing in Ohio this time. Please relax and enjoy this edition of The Starters.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Introduces the starter for the Green Bay Packers. At left end, number 22, from Marquette, Laverne Dilwig. Left tackle, number 40, from Cincinnati, Cal Hubbard. Left guard, number 32, from Alabama, Jim Madone. Center, number 29, from Wisconsin, Bernie Darling. Right guard, number 36, from Penn State, Mike Mikulski. Right tackle, number 33, from Pittsburgh, Bill Kern. Right end, number 37, from Georgia, Tom Nash. Quarterback, number 17, from Marquette, Red Dunn. Left halfback, number 31, from Nebraska, Vern Llewellyn. Right halfback, 33, from South Dakota State, Wirt England. Fullback, number 27, from Michigan, Bo Melinda. And head coach, Earl Lambeau, and the rest of the Green Bay Packers. Now, introducing the starters for your Portsmouth Spartans. Then, number 72, from Loyola, Illinois, Chuck Bravely. Left tackle, number 12, from Washington and Jefferson, Forrest Dews. Left guard, number 50, from Iowa, Fred Roberts. Center, number 51, from Georgia, Gene Smith. Right guard, 23, Al Brand. Right tackle, number 63, from Kansas State, George Lyon. Right end, number 7, from Ohio State, Red Joseph. Quarterback, one from Montana State, Forrest Peter. Left halfback, 24, Georgia Tech, Roy Lumpkin. Right halfback, 21, from Indiana, Chuck Bennett. Fullback, 26, from Northwestern, Tiny Lewis. And head coach, Al Griffith, and the rest of the Portsmouth Spartans. Officials for today's game. Referee, Mr. James Durfee from Columbus. Umpire, Mr. Robert Karch from Columbus. And linesman, Mr. Al Dudley from Dayton. The captain will now meet the officials at midfield for the coin toss. Portsmouth has won the toss and chosen to receive it.
Differing from last season's rout of the Chicago Bears at Wrigley, Green Bay found themselves in a real fight. The game was riddled with penalties and turnovers. League president Joe Carr watched the game from his box while smoking cigars. After all the dust settled, the game finished in a tie, 6-6. Both sides scored a touchdown in the second quarter, and both sides missed the extra point wide. With this tie, the Packers edged out the Giants for the title. Later that evening, President Carr sent this message to Green Bay at their hotel. My congratulations! When the smallest city in the league can win the championship twice in a row, it is something to be proud of, and I am just as proud of Green Bay as any of the 100 Packer followers up in Wisconsin. This video is dedicated to the Cancer Couch Foundation and its founder, Rebecca Timlin Scalera. The Cancer Couch is a 501c3 nonprofit corporation founded in Southport, Connecticut by Rebecca Timlin Scalera, PhD, breast cancer activist, neuropsychologist, and published author. Established in 2016 to raise money for research exclusively on metastatic breast cancer, the Cancer Couch Foundation has helped put over $3 million into MBC research to date. All donations and fundraising event proceeds go to fund MBC research. Not only do 100% of donations and proceeds go straight to the cause, but every dollar donated through the foundation is matched, making twice the impact in half of the time. The Cancer Couch believes in precision medicine and patient-driven research. They carefully select the most promising, cutting-edge scientists in the field at the world's leading cancer centers, the Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center and the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. The Cancer Couch wants to move the needle quickly and is therefore privately funded and volunteer-run. While there are more and more treatments becoming available for metastatic breast cancer, there is still no cure, and the average prognosis remains at 2 to 3 years. On December 14, 2019, at the young age of 47, Cancer Couch founder, Rebecca Timlin Scalera, beloved wife and mother of two, was taken from us as a result of metastatic breast cancer. Rebecca left an incredible legacy and footprint behind, and the Cancer Couch Foundation continues Rebecca's mission to accelerate and substantially improve treatment and outcomes for those currently living with metastatic breast cancer. If you would like more information on the Cancer Couch and how you can continue to help Rebecca's fight, please visit thecancercouch.com. Thank you for your support.